Hello everyone. Today we are going to start a new topic, that is general exception, that is given under chapter 4 of the Indian Penal Code, that starts from section 76 to section 106 of the Indian Penal Code. And this particular topic is given in unit number 3 of your syllabus. So this particular topic is the बिगिनिंग ऑफ द इंडियन पिनल कोड. अब तक आप लोगों ने जो पढ़ा वो बस एक ट्रेलर था. अब यहाँ से हम इंडियन पिनल कोड को स्टार्ट करने जा रहे हैं और वहां पे हम देखेंगे कि एक्चुअली व्हाट द इंडियन पिनल कोड इज एंड हाउ टू स्टडी इंडियन पिनल कोड एंड व्हाट आर द वेरियस जनरल एक्सेप्शंस एंड व्हाट आर द वेरियस प्रोविजंस विद रिस्पेक्ट टू द डिफेंसेस अवेलेबल टू द अक्यूज्ड पर्सन. सो दिस पर्टिकुलर चैप्टर जनरल एक्सेप्शन that is start from section 76 to section 106 and from section 96 to section 106 is the general defenses. This particular chapter general exception, it is divided into two parts. Number one, the excusable act, and number two, the justifiable act. You must see that this particular line, that excusable act and the justifiable act. And here the excusable act is now further divided into three parts. Mistake of facts, that is given under section 76 and section 79 of the Indian Penal Code. Accident, that is section 80 of the Indian Penal Code. And the incapability, and here the incapability is now further divided into three parts or three subsection, like infancy, insanity, and intoxication. Infancy is given under section 82 and 83, where if a child who is below the age of 7 years is committing the crime, then it shall not be a crime at all. Or if a child who is above the age of 7 years but below the age of 12 years, then if he has committed crime, then whether he shall be responsible for the offense or not, that we would study under section 83 of the Indian Penal Code. Similarly, insanity. If any person who is committing crime in case of insanity, then whether he shall be punished or not, that is given under section 84 of the Indian Penal Code. And again, the intoxication, that is given under section 85 and 86 of the Indian Penal Code, where we study the incapability, whether the person shall be punished or not, what kind of defenses would be available to that person if he is committing the offense in case of incapability. Now come to the another aspect of general exception, that is justifiable act. It is not justiciable act, rather it is a justifiable act. And here the justifiable act are now further divided into various subparts. For example, the judicial act. And here the judicial act is now further divided into two parts. The act of a judge, that is section 77. If a judge, while acting judicially, did something wrong, then there is a defense available to the judges. Similarly, act done in pursuant to the order of the court. If any person who is following the order of the court, and if he is committing any crime or anything wrong, but it was in pursuant to the order of the court and it was a bona fide mistake, then again the person can claim exemption under this particular section, that is section 78 of the Indian Penal Code. Again, we have necessity, that is also a justifiable act. If a person doing something in case of necessity, then again he shall be exempted from the criminal liability, that is given under section 81 of the Indian Penal Code. The duress, that is given under section 94. If the person is committing an offense in case of duress, then he shall be exempted from the criminal liability. The consent, with consent or without consent. With consent has been given under section 87 to 89 of the Indian Penal Code, and without consent is given under section 92 of the Indian Penal Code. Basically, these particular sections are giving exemption to the doctor who is operating over the patient. So the doctor may operate over the patient with consent or without consent, and he can claim exemption under these particular sections. Similarly, the communication, communication is also a defense given to the accused person. Trifle, that's very negligible thing. If a very negligible thing which the law is not taking into consideration, then again the person can claim exemption in case of trifle. And starting from section 96 to section 106, the defenses are available. The general defenses are available, and we call it the private defenses. So if any person committing an offense like murder, and if that fall under section 100 or section 103 of the Indian Penal Code, then he can be exempted from the criminal liability. So these all things we would study in our upcoming lectures, that what we call the mistake, what we call the mistake of fact, the accident, the incapability, infancy, insanity, intoxication, the judicial act, necessity, duress, consent, communication, trifle, and the right of private defense. That we would study in our latter part of our lecture series. Now come to the point. What we call the justifiable act. अब problem ये आती है कि हम किसे justifiable act बोलेंगे और किसे excusable act बोलेंगे. In case of excusable act, the necessary mens rea for the offence is lacking. जो necessary mens rea होता, as you know, for commission of the crime, there must be actus reus and mens rea, both must coexist. But in case of excusable act, in case of the bona fide mistake, the necessary mens rea is lacking. The necessary mens rea is unavailable, and therefore the person can claim exemption in case of the excusable act, like the act done in case of mistake of fact, the act done in case of accident, the act done in case of insanity, the act done in case of infancy or intoxication. In all these cases, the necessary mens rea is absent. For example, someone is insane, and in case of that insane delusion, he committed an offense of murder. In such a situation, the person cannot be punished by virtue of section 84 of the Indian Penal Code. Similarly, if a child who is below the age of 7 years, so due to infancy, he cannot understand the nature and consequence of the act, and thereby the necessary mens rea is absent, and therefore he cannot be convicted for the offense. And he can claim exemption under section 82 and section 83 of the Indian Penal Code. Now come to a very important aspect of the mistake of fact, that is justifiable act. We have two terms called justiciable and justifiable act. These are the two terms by which you might have very much confused, that what we call the justiciable act and what we call the justifiable act. In case of justifiable act, the offense committed furnished legal justification. Agar koi bhi crime koi karta hai, to us crime par usko ek legal justification hota hai ki that why this particular person did particular crime. For example, section 77, if a judge committing an act by virtue of any law, the law has given him power that to do certain act, and thereby he did an act, but in that course of act he did something wrong, so it furnishes a legal justification. Similarly, the person doing an act under the direction of the court, or if the person is committing in necessity, suppose करिए कि कहीं पे आग लग गई, उस आग को बुझाने के लिए दो चार लोग आए और उस बुझाने में कहीं कोई नुकसान होता है, then again there is legal justification for the act, and therefore it furnishes a legal justification, it furnishes a ground, that is it furnishes a ground of justification, and thereby the person can be exempted from the criminal liability. And here the legal justification means the good reason to do. The person is having a very good reason to do certain act, and here there is necessary mens rea. Here the necessary mens rea is available, and he is doing to do something good to the society, and thereby he can claim exemption. For example, section 77, section 78, 81, and 89 of the Indian Penal Code. Similarly, we have section 94 that also furnishes a legal justification for doing certain act. Now, the point is what we call the Justiciable Act. That's a very important point, that what we call the Justiciable Act. Here, the Justiciable Act means proper to be examined in the court of law. An act which has to be examined in the court of law, that is called the Justiciable Act. And here, it is subject to the trial before the court of law. The court will examine the matter, the court will examine the facts, and thereafter will apply the law. So it is subject to the trial before the court of law, and therefore it is called the Justiciable Act, and the court has to do justice in this particular matter. Similarly, there are certain non-justiciable act. For example, the directive principle of a state policy. The directive principle of a state policy cannot be challenged in any court of law, and therefore it is called the non-justiciable act. So hope you understood that what we call the justiciable act. In case of justiciable act, the person the offense committed furnish a legal justification. There is legal justification for doing such act. And in case of Justiciable Act, the post the matter can be challenged before the court of law, and the court is having power to examine the matter, and the court is having power to do justice in that particular matter. And in case of non-justiciable act, the court is having no power to look into the matter, and it cannot be examined before the court of law. Now come to the point. Section 6 of the Indian Penal Code. Here, the Section 6 is called the I of IPC. Why it is called I of IPC? ऐसी क्या जरूरत पड़ी या ऐसी क्या बात है Section 6 में कि इसे हम I of IPC बोलते हैं? The reason is the definition in the code to be understood subject to the general exception. This is the marginal note of Section 6 of the Indian Penal Code, that all the definition, all the exceptions are read subject to the general exception. So wherever under the Indian Penal Code, if any definition is given, if any principle is given, then that has to be read subject to the general exception. मतलब ये हुआ कि कोई भी क्राइम ऑफ लेट अस टेक एन एग्जांपल. सपोज कि ए ने कोई क्राइम किया, ए ने ऑफेंस ऑफ थेफ्ट किया, और थेफ्ट करने के बाद ही इज अगेन हैविंग डिफेंसेस अवेलेबल अंडर चैप्टर 4 ऑफ द इंडियन पिनल कोड, दैट इज जनरल एक्सेप्शन, एंड ही कैन क्लेम एग्जेम्पशन अंडर अंडर द एनी ऑफ द प्रोविजंस ऑफ द जनरल exception, and therefore all the definition given under the Indian Penal Code are subject to the general exception, and therefore it is called the I of IPC. Now come to the point, the burden of proof. By general exception ke case mein burden of proof kis pe lay hota hai? Who shall be responsible to prove the case beyond all reasonable doubt? In case of general exception, the burden of proof lie over the accused person and not over the prosecution. अगर वो कहता है कि मेरा केस जनरल एक्सेप्शन में फॉल करता है, then he must prove before the court of law that he can claim exemption, and he is liable for the exemption under the general exception, and he shall not be punished. So it should be proved before the court of law. So we have section 104-105 of the Indian Evidence Act 1872, which giving power to the accused to prove the general exception. So here the burden lie over the accused to prove that his case is falling under the general exception. So as per section 105, for bringing the case within any of the general exceptions or within any of the special exception or proviso contained in any other part of the Indian Penal Code or the same code or any law defining the offense is upon the accused. So here the heavy burden lie over the accused to prove that his case is falling in the general exception, and the court shall presume the absence of the such circumstances. It is very important line that the court shall presume that there is an absence of the general exception. There is an absence that the accused case is falling in the general exception. But it is the duty over the accused to prove that his case is falling in general exception. Now, Come to section 76 of the Indian Penal Code. As per section 76, the marginal note, act done by person bound or by mistake of fact, believing himself bound by law. That is the marginal note, act done by person. Here, this defense is available to every person, whether Indian citizen or not. And if he is bound by law to do it, then there is a defense available to the person under section 76. So section 76 deals with the two things. Number one, if the person is bound by law, then there is defense. Point number one, if the person is bound by law and if he did certain acts, then he shall be exempted from the criminal liability. And number two, or by mistake of fact, believing himself to be bound by law. Again, the person is bound by law by mistake of fact. He did something in the mistake of fact, then again he shall be exempted from the criminal liability. But section 76 is, it says nothing is an offense which is done by a person who is bound by law to do it. So what you have to do is, you have to read first line with the last line. The first line you have to read with the last line, that nothing is an offense which is done by a person who is bound by law to do it. If the person is bound by law to do it, then it is not an offense. You must keep in mind that nothing is an offense. It shall not be an offense at all, even though if he committed the offense of murder. And if the person is bound by law to do it, then it shall not be an offense at all. It shall not be an offense at all, because the person is bound by law to do it. Now come to the point number two. The point number two is, nothing is an offense which is done by a person who, by reason of mistake of fact plus not by reason of mistake of law, in good faith believes himself to be bound by law to do it. So what we understood is that under section 76 there are two things, that nothing is an offense which is done by a person who is bound by law to do it. If the person is bound by law to do it, then it shall not be an offense at all, because he is bound by law to do it. For example, if an officer asking the constable to open fire over the mob, in such a situation he is bound by law, he is bound by the order of the superior, and thereby he is opening the fire, and therefore it shall not be an offense. That we will study later, that when it would amount to an offense and when it would not amount to an offense. Now come to the point number two, that if it was done by reason of mistake of fact, if it was done under mistake of fact, then again it shall not be an offense. If the act was done, if the offense was done in the mistake of fact, we will study later that what we call the mistake of fact. But here, for sake of understanding section 76, if the act is done under mistake of fact, then it shall not be an offense. But it has certain other ingredients, like not by reason of mistake of law. So of course it was done under mistake of fact, but it was not under the mistake of law, and it was done in the good faith, and he believes himself to be bound by law to do it. The person is believing himself that he is bound by law to do it, and it was done in good faith, and it was not done under mistake of law, it was done under the mistake of fact, and therefore it shall not be an offense. And thereby it is saying that nothing is an offense which is done by a person who, by reason of mistake of fact and not by reason of mistake of law, in good faith believes himself to be bound by law to do it. Come to a very famous Latin maxim, that is ignorantia facti excusat. Ignorance of fact is excusable. Ignorance of fact is excusable. And the second maxim is ignorantia juris non excusat. Ignorance of law has no excuse. These are the two most important Latin maxims with respect to mistake of fact, that ignorantia facti excusat. That means ignorance of fact is excusable. If the a person is ignorance of fact, then it is excusable. And ignorance of law has no excuse at all. If the person is breaking the law, then it has no excuse at all. So It follows the doctrine of mens rea. Ignorantia facti excusat. It follows the doctrine of mens rea. What does it mean? That in case of mistake of fact, there is absence of mens rea, and therefore the person can be exempted from the criminal liability. Or in simple terms, it is called the factual error. There is a factual error on the part of the accused, and therefore he can be exempted from the criminal liability. Now, come to the point, the facts. What we call the fact, as per section 3 of the Indian Evidence Act, where the term facts has been defined, and as per section 3, it says the state of things which can be perceived by senses, that is the fact. For example, certain things are arranged in certain manner. Aapke ghar mein TV, fridge, cooler, sab ek ऑर्डर में अरेंज है कि भाई किचन है जहाँ पे, तो वहाँ पे और भी सामान होगा, गैस चूल्हा होगा, और भी बर्तन होंगे. सो कुछ चीजें सर्टेन ऑर्डर में अरेंज है, एंड दैट इफ दैट कैन बी परसीव बाय सेंसेस, आपकी आंखों से, आपके हाथों से, आपके लेग से, स्किन से, स्मेल से, अगर वो चीज परसीव होती है, देन इट इज अ फैक्ट. इफ सर्टेन थिंग्स आर अरेंज इन सर्टेन मैनर, अगर आप क्लासरूम में बैठे हुए हैं, आप एक सर्टेन ऑर्डर में बैठे हुए हैं, दैट इज अ फैक्ट. अगर कोई क्लास चल रही है, दैट इज अ फैक्ट. लाइक थिंग्स विच कैन बी परसीव्ड बाय सेंसेस, आप अपने मोबाइल को टच कर सकते हैं, अपने लैपटॉप को छू सकते हैं, लैपटॉप को देख सकते हैं, या आप अपने फैन को ऑन कर सकते हैं, फैन को ऑफ कर सकते हैं, विच कैन बी परसीव्ड बाय सेंसेस, देन दैट इज द फैक्ट. और रिलेशन ऑफ थिंग, इवन अ रिलेशन ऑफ थिंग इज सेड टू बी अ फैक्ट. अगर किसी ने कोई बात बोली, इफ समवन सेड समथिंग, दैट इज अ फैक्ट. मैं आपको लेक्चर दे रहा हूँ, दैट इज अ फैक्ट. आपने कुछ मुझसे क्वेश्चन पूछा, दैट इज द फैक्ट. स्टूडेंट एग्जाम दे रहे हैं, दैट इज द फैक्ट. सो इवन द स्टेट ऑफ थिंग्स, रिलेशन ऑफ थिंग्स, और थिंग्स विच कैन बी परसीव्ड बाय सेंसेस, एवरीथिंग विच कैन बी परसीव्ड बाय सेंसेस इज कॉल्ड अ फैक्ट. किसी ने कुछ कहा, किसी पॉलिटिशियन, जैसे अभी फिलहाल बिहार का इलेक्शन हो रहा है, तो अगर किसी पॉलिटिशियन ने स्पीच दी, दैट इज अ फैक्ट. किसी वोटर ने कोई बात कही कि यहाँ पे डेवलपमेंट हुआ या नहीं हुआ, दैट इज अ फैक्ट. सो वॉट एवर द पर्सन इज सेइंग समथिंग, स्पीकिंग समथिंग, इवन फॉर्मिंग एन ओपिनियन कैन बी टर्म्ड एज फैक्ट. फॉर्मिंग एन ओपिनियन कैन बी टर्म्ड एज फैक्ट. वन ऑफ द मोस्ट इंपॉर्टेंट एस्पेक्ट of this mistake of fact is how this presumption is made. कैसे आप बोलोगे कि this is the mistake of fact और ये mistake of fact नहीं है? आप कब कहोगे कि this is the fact and this is not the fact? ये mistake हुआ है और ये mistake of fact है और ये mistake of law है, कब आप बोलोगे? Here, when the appearance is congruent to reality. Congruent आपने high school 8th standard में पढ़ा होगा कि when A is equal to B, when triangle A is congruent to triangle B, then one angle and one side is equal to other angle and other side. That you might have studied. So for the sake of our understanding, when A congruent to R, or we can say when appearance is congruent to reality, जो चीज अपीयर होती है वही चीज अगर रियलिटी में भी होती है तो उसको हम ट्रू बोलेंगे. जैसे अगर मैंने कहा कि दिस इज द डस्टर, वो मुझे अपीयर हो रहा है कि ये एक डस्टर है, और रियलिटी में भी अगर वो डस्टर है, देन दैट इज ट्रू. बट अगर मैंने कहा कि ये डस्टर है बट एक्चुअली इन रियलिटी इट इज अ चॉक, देन इट इज फॉल्स. A is not congruent to R, appearance is not equal to reality, then that is called a false assumption, that is called a false presumption. So when appearance is equal to reality, then we call it a true fact, and when appearance is not equal to reality, then we call it a wrong fact or the false fact. जैसे एक live example आपको दूं कि आपके घर में कोई रस्सी पड़ी हुई है, यू हैव अ रोप इन योर हाउस, और डिम लाइट में आपने इसे देखा और आपने सोचा कि ये कोई स्नेक है, कोई सांप है. यू सॉ अ रोप इन योर रूम एंड यू अंडरस्टूड दैट इट इज अ स्नेक. व्हाट डज इट मीन? इट अपीयर टू बी अ स्नेक बट इट इज अ रोप. इन अपियरेंस इट अपीयर टू बी अ स्नेक बट इन रियलिटी इट इज अ rope. What does it mean? Appearance is not equal to reality and therefore it is a false assumption. या आपने कोई रात में कोई बड़े से पेड़ को देखा और उसको देख करके आपको लगा कि ये कोई इंसान है या ये कोई घोस्ट है. सो हियर द अपीयरेंस इज नॉट इक्वल टू रियलिटी एंड देयरफॉर इट इज अ मिस्टेक ऑफ फैक्ट. इट इज अ मिस्टेक ऑफ फैक्ट. सो व्हाट वी अंडरस्टूड इज दैट व्हेन सब्जेक्ट इज इक्वल टू ऑब्जेक्ट, जो सब्जेक्ट है वही ऑब्जेक्ट अगर हो जाता है देन इट इज ट्रू. And when subject is not equal to object, then it is false. So, when appearance is not equal to reality and we come on the wrong conclusion, then here there is some want of knowledge. Here there is some want of knowledge. और भी आपको थोड़ा सा और नॉलेज होना चाहिए था. आपने रस्सी को देख करके उसको सांप समझ लिया, दैट मीन्स कि थोड़ा सा और नॉलेज आपके पास होता तो आप रस्सी को रस्सी ही समझते, आप रोप को रोप ही समझते. इसलिए जो है यहाँ पे कुछ थोड़ी सी नॉलेज की कमी रह गई एंड देयरफॉर अपीयरेंस इज नॉट इक्वल टू रियलिटी. अब आपके पास एक टर्म है कॉल्ड इग्नोरेंस ऑफ फैक्ट एंड नंबर टू मिस्टेक ऑफ फैक्ट. हमारे लॉ में सेक्शन 76 में वी हैव टर्म कॉल्ड मिस्टेक ऑफ फैक्ट, जबकि लैटिन मैगजीन इज अबाउट इग्नोरेंस ऑफ फैक्ट. इग्नोरेंस ऑफ फैक्ट इज एक्सक्यूजेड, इग्नोरेंस ऑफ फैक्ट इज एक्सक्यूजेबल. तो अब प्रॉब्लम ये आती है कि दोनों में फिर डिफरेंस क्या है, व्हाट इज इग्नोरेंस एंड व्हाट इज मिस्टेक, वेदर बोथ आर सेम और वेदर बोथ आर डिफरेंट थिंग. सो हियर द मिस्टेक एंड इग्नोरेंस बोथ कैन बी यूज्ड इंटरचेंजेबली. पहली बात, इन जनरल मिस्टेक एंड इग्नोरेंस बोथ कैन बी यूज्ड इंटरचेंजेबली एंड बेसिकली इग्नोरेंस इज लैक ऑफ नॉलेज. इग्नोरेंस मींस द लैक ऑफ नॉलेज. ही इज टोटली इग्नोरेंस ऑफ द नॉलेज एंड ही नेवर कम इनटू कांटेक्ट विद द ऑब्जेक्ट. आपको कभी कुछ पता ही नहीं था, आप वो उस रूम में आए ही नहीं कि वो सांप है या रस्सी है, वो टिम्बर है या इंसान है, आप कभी उस जगह पहुंचे ही नहीं एंड देयरफॉर यू नेवर कम इनटू कांटेक्ट विद द ऑब्जेक्ट. देयर इज कंप्लीट इग्नोरेंस ऑफ नॉलेज, देयर इज कंप्लीट लैक ऑफ नॉलेज. आपने कुछ किया ही नहीं उस मैटर पे एंड देयरफॉर इट इज कॉल्ड इग्नोरेंस. बट इन केस ऑफ मिस्टेक द पर्सन कम इनटू कांटेक्ट विद द ऑब्जेक्ट. पर्सन जो है उस ऑब्जेक्ट के कांटेक्ट में आता है, वो उस जगह को जाकर के देखता है कि भाई ये सांप है या रस्सी है, उसको वो दूर से देख करके समझता है कि नहीं नहीं ये रस्सी नहीं ये तो सांप है, ये स्नेक है. व्हाट डज इट मीन? द पर्सन इज कमिंग इनटू कांटेक्ट विद द रोप, द पर्सन इज कमिंग इनटू कांटेक्ट विद द स्नेक, द पर्सन इज कमिंग इनटू कांटेक्ट विद द ऑब्जेक्ट, बट ही कम ऑन द रॉन्ग कंक्लूजन. वो एक रॉन्ग कंक्लूजन पे आता है एंड ही इज हैविंग सम रॉन्ग नॉलेज, सम नॉलेज अबाउट इट. ही इज हैविंग सम नॉलेज बट दैट कंक्लूजन इज रॉन्ग. ही इज रीचिंग ऑन सम कंक्लूजन एंड द कंक्लूजन इज रॉन्ग. सो व्हाट वी अंडरस्टूड इज दैट इन केस ऑफ इग्नोरेंस द पर्सन नेवर कम इन टू कॉन्टेक्ट विद द ऑब्जेक्ट एंड देयरफॉर ही इज हैविंग कंप्लीट इग्नोरेंस ऑफ नॉलेज और ही इज हैविंग कंप्लीट लैक ऑफ नॉलेज. पॉइंट नंबर वन. Point number two, that in case of mystic, the person come into contact with the object and he come on the wrong conclusion. He deduced some wrong conclusion and here the person thereby make a mistake. The person makes a mistake. So he always supposes some error of opinion. There is some error of opinion as to the real facts. Real facts ke bare mein wo ek error of opinion form karta hai and therefore we call it a mistake of fact. So hope you understood that what we call the mistake of fact and what we call the ignorance of fact. Ignorance of fact mein person come into person never come into contact with the object and in case of mistake of fact the person come into contact with the object but he come on the wrong conclusion. There is a term called transferred malice or transfer of malice. अब सपोज करिए कि बहू अपने सासू माँ से बहुत परेशान है, वो अपने सासू माँ को मारना चाहती है, तो इंस्टीड ऑफ किलिंग सासू माँ, इंस्टीड ऑफ किलिंग मदर इन लॉ, सी किल्ड सिस्टर इन लॉ. इंस्टीड ऑफ किलिंग मदर इन लॉ, सी किल्ड सिस्टर इन लॉ. और इंस्टीड ऑफ किलिंग ए, the accused killed A dash. Instead of killing B, he killed B dash. तो क्या इस केस में उसको सजा मिलेगी? Whether the person will be responsible or whether he can claim an exemption under section 76 on the ground of mistake of fact कि वो मारना चाहती थी सासू माँ को और जो है ननद की डेथ हो गई. Whether she can claim exemption under section 76? Certainly not. Certainly not. Here she will be responsible on the basis of transferred malice. Malice would be transferred and thereby she would be made responsible for the offense committed by her or the her or him. Since malice itself is not punishable, malice jo hai apne aap mein punishable nahi hai unless it satisfies some condition. So even the person is by mistake killing someone else, causing some different offense, still the person will be responsible for the act done by him and he cannot claim exemption on the ground of mistake of fact. Hope you have understood that what we call the mistake of fact. In our next video lecture, we will study that what is called the act done by person who is bound by law to do it. And we will study in detail all these things. Thank you. Thank you very much.